I now can sing since I've been redeemed.
I'm on the everlasting rock.
I faith in Christ, my Redeemer King.
I'm on the everlasting rock.
This is the voice of hope.
Spirit of holiness, descend thy people, wait for thee. Thine ear in kind compassion lend, let us thy mercy. Spirit of holiness, is thine to hear our feeble prayer. Come, for we wait thy power divine. Let us thy mercy share.
Thank you, men, for inviting the Holy Spirit to be present with us as we look into God's Word. And thank you for joining me today for this edition of The Voice of Hope. I'm J. Mark Horst, your friend and Bible teacher. Today's teaching is from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verses 8 to 17, and our subject is Love the Truth. You know, truth is an extremely valuable commodity in our day because there's so much deception. Many people reject even the suggestion that absolute truth exists. In their minds, truth is subjective. In other words, it is whatever they want it to be. Now, that may be a convenient way to live, but eventually, it leads to disillusionment, to heartache, and to eternal ruin. Maybe you've heard this statement, "God said it, I believe it, and that settles it." I have a bit of a problem with that statement. Why? Because whether I believe it or not, if God said it, that settles it. Truth isn't dependent on my believing it. It stands by itself. Here on The Voice of Hope, we believe in absolute truth, the truth of God's Word. And that's why, on every program, we bring you teaching from a portion of the Scriptures. So stay tuned for my teaching, Love the Truth, from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. What is truth? You might remember that was the question Pilate asked Jesus at his trial. How would you define truth? I once heard a definition that I really like. It says, truth is reality from God's point of view. The title of our study today is Love the Truth, and our text is 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verses 8 to 17. I read about a pastor who starts each confirmation class at his church with a jar full of beans. And he asks his students to guess how many beans are in the jar, and then he writes down their estimates. Then alongside those estimates, he helps them make another list, a list of their favorite songs. When both lists are complete, then he tells them actually how many beans are in the jar. The whole class then, of course, as you can imagine, looks over their guesses to see who was the closest to being right. And then the pastor turns to the list of favorite songs, and he asks them this, "And which one of these songs is closest to being right?" Well, immediately, the students protest there is no right answer because a person's favorite song is a matter of taste. Now, this pastor holds a PhD in philosophy from Notre Dame, and he asks his students, "When you decide what to believe in terms of your faith, is that more like guessing the number of beans or more like choosing your favorite song?" What do you think they answer? He said always, from old as well as young, he gets the same answer. Choosing one's faith is more like choosing a favorite song. So somebody asked this pastor, "After they say that, do you still confirm them?" And he smiled and said, "First, I try to argue them out of it." Now, I have to say I don't support that pastor's actions, but the illustration helps us understand where most people are today with respect to truth. It was Winston Churchill who once said, "Men occasionally stumble over the truth, but most of them pick themselves up and hurry off as if nothing has happened. Sadly, that's our culture with regard to truth, and it has infected much of professing Christianity. According to pollster George Barna, only about 20% of those who identify as born again agree that there is such a thing as absolute truth. That's less than a quarter. So it's not surprising that 60% of that same group, the born agains, agree that Christians, Jews, Muslims, Buddhists, and others all pray to the same God. They just use different names for God. Have you ever been in a setting where the Bible is being studied and someone asks this question? What does this passage mean to you? Is that a good question? You know, really what the passage means to me may be irrelevant. It may be erroneous, and it may be something worse. The real question is, what does the passage mean? Because you and I won't be judged on the basis of what we think the text means. We will be judged on what it actually does mean. This is a critical distinction if you and I want to develop a love for the truth. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 8 to 17 is our text for today, and it gives us details about certain end-time events. But that's not where our focus is going to be. Our focus is going to be on learning how to love the truth and learning how to avoid those things that hinder us from learning to love the truth. But because verse 8 speaks of a character who is introduced earlier in the text, I'm going to take the liberty to read the entire chapter. So listen as I read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to Him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as though the day of Christ had come. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? And now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders, and with all the unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth, that they might be saved. And for this reason, God will send them strong delusion, that they should believe the lie, that they all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. But we are bound to give thanks to God always for you, brethren beloved by the Lord, because God from the beginning chose you for salvation through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth, to which he called you by our gospel, for the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, brethren, stand fast and hold the traditions which you were taught, whether by word or our epistle. Now, may our Lord Jesus Christ himself, and our God and Father who has loved us and given us everlasting consolation and good hope by grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good word and work. This text reveals responses to the truth that affect the degree to which you and I will learn to love the truth. The first response is, reject the truth. And I won't spend much time here because I assume most of you are listening because you want to better understand the truth and not reject it. But it's important for us to understand how highly intelligent people can be taken in by such outrageous lies. The early part of this chapter, if you were listening, spoke about the man of sin, or the Antichrist. He succeeds, through his smooth speech and his false miracles and his military power, to make followers of the vast majority of the people who are on earth at that time. And we wonder, how can this be? How can he be so successful? Well, let's zero in on what I believe is a key phrase in verse 10. Paul wrote, "Because they received not the love of the truth." Now, remember our earlier question? What does this phrase mean? The word receive, as it's used here, means to receive favorably or to embrace, to make something one's own. Our text says that those who refuse to receive the truth and embrace it will be deceived. I know that many of you are aware that there are different Greek words for the English word love. And interestingly, the Holy Spirit inspired Paul to use the word agape to refer to this love of the truth. Kenneth Woost says, "Agape speaks of that love which springs from an awakened sense of value in an object, which causes one to prize the object that is loved. It expresses the love of approval, of esteem, as over against the love of pure delight, that would be phileo. It, that is agape, springs from a comprehension of the preciousness of the object that is loved." Now listen, it derives its impulse more from the notion of prizing than of liking. So Paul says those who are perishing do so because of their gullibility, and their gullibility is caused by the fact they don't love the truth. They don't understand the value and the preciousness of truth. They don't embrace truth and make it the rule for their life and conduct. Romans 1:28 speaks of God giving people over to a reprobate mind. And the process of reprobation in that chapter begins back in verse 18. Let me read it for you. "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold or suppress the truth in unrighteousness." So not only do these deceived ones fail to prize the truth, but they also suppress it from being proclaimed. And because of this, God will allow them to become so deluded they will believe the lie, that is, they will embrace the Antichrist. Because the rejection of truth is so prevalent in our culture, pressure is building on all of us as genuine followers of Christ to keep our biblical convictions to ourselves. So let's beware of those who reject the truth of God's Word, because that rejection affects every one of their decisions and actions. The second response, then, is believe the truth. My mentor, Dr. J. Otis Yoder, related a conversation he had with a college student back in his teaching days. The student said to him, "I can't believe." To which Brother Yoder responded, "No, what you're really saying is, I will not believe. No one can truthfully say, I cannot believe, because belief is an act of the will." Look with me now at verse 13. In contrast to those who reject the truth, God chooses to save those who believe the truth. And this belief, according to Thayer's dictionary, is conviction or belief respecting man's relationship to God and divine things. And generally, it includes an idea of trust and holy fervor born of faith and joined with it. And so belief is not mere mental assent. James wrote about that kind of belief. He said, "You believe there is one God, you do well. But the demons also believe and tremble." The biblical understanding of belief is the acceptance of truth with a corresponding change of life. Pastor Justin Lonas says, "Being a follower of Christ is a much more significant and costly endeavor than simply being saved. It is a calling to the abundant life in Him." Amen. It leads us to a deeper understanding of the value of truth and how that value transforms our lives. And so I ask you, how is your belief of the truth transforming your life? Those who genuinely accept truth cannot promote a cheap grace or a gospel of easy believism. You know, the truth of the gospel isn't difficult to understand, but it's hard to act upon because it calls us to abandon our lives to the control of Christ. That's the cost of discipleship. The gospel calls us to accept by faith things we can't reason out in our minds. And that doesn't mean that the gospel is illogical. It just means the gospel transcends our human logic and our understanding. Belief in God's word isn't a blind leap of faith into the dark, as we're sometimes accused. It is the reasoned assurance that because God has revealed himself to mankind in a multitude of ways, he is able to arrange the circumstances of my life in a way that glorifies him. And in that process, he brings me to my fullest potential as one made in his image. And so belief is synonymous with trust. And then there's another response to the truth. It is retain the truth. Our belief of the truth secures for us the glory of Christ. That's what Paul says in verse 14. This amazing gift is part of our salvation. And so in verse 15, Paul exhorts us to take active measures to retain the truth or to guard it. And there are numerous scriptures that warn us about the possibility of our drifting away from the truth or letting it slip. So he says we are to be constantly standing firm, to persevere. It's an active process, not an event. And you know, this is so necessary in our day because there's a constant barrage of rhetoric from all sides that only those who are bigoted and egotistical will claim to know something called absolute truth. And so we have statements like these: live and let live, or God accepts people just the way they are. You know, that last statement is true with regard to salvation, but not with regard to discipleship, because God wants to change all of us into the likeness of Christ. And then Paul says that we should hold tenaciously to the traditions. Oh, did I say a bad word? We are to hold tenaciously to the traditions we have been taught. Now, I realize traditions can be negative as well as positive. You might recall that Jesus rebuked the Pharisees for their traditions because they negated God's commands. But let's not overreact to the word traditions. In this text and others, it simply means a recognized body of teaching. Paul gives expanded teaching on this in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 13. I have a whole sermon on verses 13 and 14, but let me share just a few thoughts from that. Let's do a little word study. Paul tells Timothy to hold fast to the form of sound words. This is an interesting phrase with practical applications in our day. The Greek word that's translated into the English word form is used only twice in the New Testament, and both times by Paul. In 1 Timothy 1:16, it is translated as pattern. The word form is made up of the Greek prefix hupo, meaning under, and the noun tupos. Woost's Word Studies says that the noun tupos means a blow. It was used of the beat of the horse's hooves, or an impression left by a seal, the effect of a blow or pressure, an engraved mark, or a pattern. And it also speaks of a pattern by which one can maintain the sameness of a thing. Now, listen, Woost goes on to say, and I'm quoting, Paul exhorts Timothy to hold fast the pattern of the sound words committed to him. That is, he is to hold to the doctrinal phraseology, or tradition, he received from the great apostle. Particular words are to be retained and used so that the doctrinal statements of truth may remain accurate and a norm for future teachers and preachers. This is vitally connected with the doctrine of verbal inspiration, which holds that the Bible writers wrote down God's chosen words, the truth given by revelation. And that's the end of the quote. If you and I hope to retain the truth, we can't ignore the doctrine of verbal plenary inspiration. This simply means the inspiration extends to the very words themselves, that's the verbal part, and that the inspiration extends to all parts of the Scripture and all subject matters of the Scripture, that's the plenary part. It doesn't mean that God mechanically dictated the words of the Bible. It means that the words express the thoughts God intended, and being correctly interpreted, are free from errors of fact and doctrine or judgment. So let's be careful not to dumb down the Word of God in our attempts to make it more understandable. We need to retain key words and concepts that show our love for the truth and our desire to guard it and keep it. There is then a final response to the truth, and that is to rest in the truth. Look with me at the final verses of this chapter. Everlasting consolation, good hope through grace, and comfort. What a glorious rest belongs to you and me if we love the truth. Several years ago, when my wife Joyce was diagnosed with cancer, the truth of God's Word took on new meaning for us. I can tell you in all honesty that we did not have one sleepless night of worry and anxiety. Did we have questions? Absolutely. Was there uncertainty? Of course. We didn't know where this journey would take us, but we rested confidently in the multitude of God's promises. Some of you listening to me have had very difficult experiences in your own lives, and maybe you're in the middle of one right now. You know exactly how much the love of the truth means to you. You've probably said what I've sometimes said in response to human suffering. I don't see how unbelievers make it through life without the power of God's presence and the security of resting in His promises. The love of the truth is an anchor in the storms of life. And I identify with the songwriter who wrote, "And the cables passed from his heart to mine can defy the blast through strength divine." The wonderful thing about resting in the truth is this: if we learn to do it now, we can experience it throughout all eternity. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke on you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest to your souls." That's Matthew 11:28-29. That soul rest is both present and future. And so I urge you, don't reject the truth. It's the only thing that can set you free. Believe the truth, test it, try it, practice it, and you will find it trustworthy. And then make it your goal to retain truth, to guard it carefully, and to pass it on to others in the way that has been passed on to you. And finally, rest in the truth. God's promises are sure and secure. He will, according to Philippians 1:6, bring to completion that good work that He has begun in you. So learn to love the truth and respond to it in these positive ways. Because if you do this, you can be confident in the promise of Jesus: you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free.
We are not alone. We are not alone. We are not alone. God is with us. We are not alone. We are not alone. We are not alone. God is with us. We are not alone.
Thank you, choir. When we embrace the truth and rest in it, we are never alone. That's a precious thought. If you've been encouraged or challenged by today's program, we'd like to know that. We always appreciate feedback from you, our listeners. Our email address is hope@heraldsofhope.org. That's hope@heraldsofhope.org. Or pick up your phone and call us toll-free at 866-960-0292. Or mail your comment to the Voice of Hope, Box 3, Breezewood, Pennsylvania, 15533. And you can use this contact information to request either a digital or print copy of today's teaching, Love the Truth. To review today's teaching or listen to archived programs, log on to our website, heraldsofhope.org, and listen at your convenience. If you want to connect with us on social media, just search for Heralds of Hope and follow us on our various social media platforms. And we also invite you to help support this ministry financially by donating securely online at heraldsofhope.org or by calling our toll-free number, 866-960-0292. And of course, you can also mail your gift to the Voice of Hope, Box 3, Breezewood, Pennsylvania, 15533. God's grace, accompanied by your fervent prayers and generous financial support, will enable the Voice of Hope to be on the air until Jesus comes in the air. Now, friend, I hope you'll join me next week for the Voice of Hope. And until we meet again, I invite you to join me in this prayer.